And then the other thing is, yeah, so he's going to tell his experience, his journey, his story, basically. So the one thing I think that we would like for you to listen for is, what in your story do you relate with? Because that tells you a lot about yourself. Different things will stand out for you. And then secondly, looking at your own interest and your personality and your strengths that we've done in Strength Finder, what of what you have can fit in with what Dévan does. So will that be a job that will work for you? He's done many things. He's a very, very interesting and innovative young man. So I think those are the things that we would like for you to listen to, because once he's left, we're going to put you into breakaway rooms so you can just discuss that with each other. But first of all, listen to his story, write down the questions that you want to ask him. Dévan, it's very difficult to stop somebody halfway. So I think we're going to keep the questions till the end of what you've said.
Perfect. Yeah.
We'll ask you all the questions. Okay.
Okay.
So the only thing I'll say about Dévan is that he did the scores, and that the thing that I know about, because one of my students 2 years ago was one of your models, says does this leather ties. But listen to your story. I hope you watch the videos over the weekend. And then Dévan, I'm going to leave it to you. Okay.
Thank you so much. Hello, all the students. And you guys can't fool me. I know that most of you guys are already laying in bed watching this from your iPhone. That's fine. I'm just glad you guys are here. I see we are 97. Before I start, I always say this before I do a presentation, is the most valuable thing that you own in your life is your time. And by giving that to me this morning means so much. So I'm going to try my best in this crazy time that we're currently in, just to try and share my story with you. So I'm going to take you from basically the start of my company, WEEF, everything that I had to go through to get to where I am now. And I think the key message that I want to leave behind here is that it's not always the destination, but it's the journey that makes it so exciting. So what I've done is I've actually tailor-made a little presentation for you guys, which I'm going to quickly share as well. Let's quickly try and do that. 1 second. Okay. Let's see. Computer sound. Share.
Okay, it's starting to share on this side.
Okay, wonderful. Let me just quickly double check. So everyone can see that screen, right?
Yeah, we can. You can just go to slideshow now.
Okay.
Oh, there's the idea.
Okay, so everyone can see this?
Yes. If anybody can't, let me or Aurelia know. Okay.
Awesome. And then as discussed, I'm going to run through this, and I've tried to make this, like I said, as short and as impactful as possible. And please ask me questions afterwards. I am here to try and answer whatever questions you guys have. So do make notes, and more than happy to answer questions. Cool. So everyone's ready? We good to go?
Yes, we're good to go. You can start.
Okay. So I think I'm starting this off with, you were made for greatness. This is something that that a big, big, well-known brand, Guinness, said on one of their campaigns. And it's always stuck with me, because it was always, that's pretty interesting, because the reality is every single one of us are made for greatness. We just don't know it yet. Mm-hmm. Before I start, I need to play an ad. For you guys, this is one of my favorite ads that I've ever seen. And I think inside of this ad, there's a lot of takeout. So I don't want to talk too much about it. I just want to quickly show you this one.
We'll be right back.
Did you hear that with the sound?
Yes.
Wonderful. This always gives me such goosebumps because I think at face value, you have a guy that had to build up courage to obviously kiss the girl for the first time. Now, I'm pretty sure everyone, every guy or girl that's ever had to do that, it's this intense feeling of, am I going to be rejected? Is this going to work? Is this going to be a complete fail? And I think this is basically one of the best ways to explain a business or about to approach something that scares you. And when I watched this, I'm a big fan of Lacoste, the brand, but when I watched this, I was like, this encompasses everything so beautifully. And I always open up my presentations with this because it's just so much power. So I hope you guys also saw that in it's literally like, and also in my journey starting WEEF, it did feel like I was jumping off a building. And it's almost like you're building your wings on the way down. Okay, so on to the next slide. This is me. And yes, I was born with a mustache. this is me. I think this photo was taken when I was like eight years old. But this little poor boy didn't know what was coming. So just to explain to you guys from top to bottom, I went to DF Milan High School. I graduated in 2007. Very confused. All my friends went to go study Stellenbosch. Everybody went to go do a degree. And I just didn't know what I wanted to do. And I know I didn't want to waste my time and I didn't want to waste my parents' money. Excuse me. So what I did was I took a gap year. So I went to America. I always wanted to go to America. I flew to America, to Chicago, where I worked in a theme park for about 6 months, where I actually wore the Bugs Bunny costume. That was amazing. And I got a lot of hugs. It was my job to hug people. And then I did that for 6 months. And then I went to go do a ski season in Colorado, where I worked on a ski slope, where I was a lift operator. So I basically got people up the mountain and snowboarded every single day, which was incredible. So if you ever wanted to do that, please do that. Then I, in that time, I realized that one of the biggest passions in my life is acting. There's something so, for me personally, it's so amazing that you could watch a movie and then through someone's acting, it can actually influence you. And that was always been this big thing that an actor has the power to influence and hopefully, you know, obviously in a positive way. Then after coming back, I was looking online and I was like, I want to do something, but I don't want it to be too long because my personality likes to do multiple things at the same time. So in 2011, I stumbled across University of Stellenbosch Business School. That time, in 2011, it was called the USB Ed Gap Year Program, which is now called the Young Minds Program, right? And I decided to partake in the course. I loved it because it was 6 months, obviously, theory, and then 6 months practical. And for me, that's cool. Like, I wanted to practice what was preached. And I think in this course, there's so much that I learned about myself and the personal mastery aspects of it, and then also just applying it to business. So this was almost like a crash course in what I wanted to do. Also, both my parents come from business backgrounds. So this was also a good platform for me to test those entrepreneurial business waters. So based on the fact that I did the course in 2011, I met a South African pop music artist called Jack Spanik, and he was super big back in 2011, 2012. And I met him at some function and he asked me what I was busy with. And I said, well, I just studied, you know, this entrepreneurial gap year program. And I'm actually about to go into my 6 month theory, practical. And he was like, well, I need someone like you, someone young, energetic with an entrepreneurial background. Don't you want to come and help out? So They had a recording studio in Cape Town, and they were recording for Jack Sparrow, for the Antwoord, so for big like South African artists. And for me, it was like, you know, like I was super starstruck, because now based on what I studied, I now got job opportunity. And long story short, I ended up working there for 2.5 years. I built 2 studios, one at Johnny De Ridder's house. He's the guitarist from Polisikar, the band Polisikar. And then also at in Cape Town, they had a second studio. And I traveled with Jax to London, where he has another studio and where he now lives as well. So this opportunity gave me international experience, and I got to learn a lot about the music industry and also about business and entrepreneurship. Then, unfortunately, 2.5 years in, some of the guys moved to London and my job became redundant, and I got retrenched from the company. Now, this I think was really hard, because at that age, I felt like I invested so much of my time and so much of my energy into this, and then all of a sudden, it's all just gone. And I think that was really a big thing. And I think the first thing you do when you get laid off, or when you made redundant, is I think you look at yourself, you know, you kind of blame yourself, you know, I wasn't good enough. Or, but I mean, the reality of the fact was that there wasn't enough, I think, you know, money to pay extra salary. So that is why, you know, I lost the job. So it took me a while to work through that. Funny enough, directly after that, I got another job at a design studio. And I was working there for 6 months. It was great. These guys did packaging design, and they did amazing logos and corporate identity. And at this agency, I met a guy called Patrick Musel. And Patrick was interning from Austria. And me and Patrick became really good friends. And 6 months later, I got retrenched again, because it was a small knit company. And they also, I mean, if you're a small company, like money is gold, like it flows. And if you don't have some of that, you have to cut costs. And unfortunately, I was let go again. And this was twice in 1 year. So obviously at this point, I'm kind of freaking out. It's really taken a toll on my, just on my mental like capacity. And so I kind of just sat down and I went, okay. So I just came from music and audio, and it opened my whole vision into the advertising world. Plus I've got design background now that I've been working with the guys for 6 months. So what I decided was to go and study at AAA, School of Advertising. So basically just to wrap everything together. And I did a postgrad there in 2014. And then I ended up working in the advertising world. And if I look at my life on the screen, I can see that everything in its own way kind of worked out. There were different paths that I had to take, but eventually I got to study acting, which was something I really enjoyed doing. And then it allowed me to work in the advertising industry, which was exactly that platform that I spoke about communicating to the masses and influencing the masses. So if you just look above there by the little asterisks, you'll see there's a little red star. During this time, so during the fact that I just lost my job for the second time, I got to know of a guy called Casey Neistat. And I don't know if there's any of you guys out there, I think you're young enough to maybe know of this guy. But Casey is a world-renowned YouTuber. He's got about 11 million subscribers on YouTube. And he's got this amazing way of telling stories. So during this crazy time in my life, somebody sent me one of his videos. I watched the video and I was completely blown away. And then I emailed Casey. Now, Casey lives in New York City. And I emailed him and I was like, you know, I just want to tell this creator that I think what he does is absolutely amazing. And I messaged him, and by amazingness, Casey replied to me. And me and Casey ended up meeting up and actually spent about 5 days together. This is a photo of me and Casey back in 2014. He was in Cape Town because he was actually getting married. He was married to a South African girl called Candace. And So just quickly put this in perspective. I'm sitting in Cape Town. I see this video. I email the creator in New York City. I still remember telling my work colleagues that if he replies, I'm going to eat my hat. This guy replies, and we ended up hanging out for 5 days. I had him on WhatsApp. And I know for some people, some people might even not know who this guy is. But for me, there was a life lesson that I could reach out to a now mega star via one email. And it took one email to get this guy's attention, and the rest is history. We ended up hanging out. I ended up chatting with him on WhatsApp. He invited me back in 2015 to behind the scenes design and Dava events. And this was just almost like my whole horizon just expanded. Like, but then anything is possible. If you can reach people from across the continent or across the globe, you know what I'm saying? One of the biggest things that stood out to me was this quote that he said, that it's better to ask forgiveness than permission. And it's basically, be as bold as you want. And you know, like that whole saying, haters are going to hate. Do what you want. And if people are going to question you, whatever, you just go, well, I'm sorry that this has offended you or whatever, but I've literally just been doing my thing. And I think a lot of people act out of jealousy because people don't want you to rise above. And I think this is one of the things, and this is what Casey's always done. And if you'll see this in his videos too, he just always does things his own way. And he's now known as the guy that makes some of the best videos his way. So he's found his flavor in that realm. Okay, so move on. So during this time, I just lost my job. I just met Casey, and now I'm going, okay, cool. I was invited to the Lurie's. Now, the Lurie's is an advertising showcase of basically brands showcasing their ads for the year. So the music and audio company asked me to go and represent them. And as you can see here, this is me on the 21st of September, 2014, and this photo was taken 10:48 p.m. I don't know if you guys know what the Lurie's is or ever went to the Lurie's, but you have to really dress to the nines. You have to take it, you know, you have to take it there. So I had brown leather shoes. And then the one thing I really wanted for my outfit was a brown leather tie. So I went to Google and I searched, and I couldn't find a brown leather tie anywhere in the world or in South Africa. So I decided to go to a local leather shop in Cape Town, and I went to go buy some off-cut leathers. And I went to a guy in Long Street. He had a little machine sitting there on the corner, and I asked him to make me a leather tie. That leather tie is exactly the one that I'm wearing there. And that tie I wore to the Lurie's. Now, you must understand that all the creative directors in the industry is in the same space for the evening. And I almost want to say maybe 150 people came to me and acknowledged the tie and told me how much they like it. They told me that their grandfathers used to have a leather tie. Where did I get it? How do they get one? So that evening kind of created a bit of a spark in the whole idea of leather ties. And I think as an entrepreneur, you kind of take that and you put that somewhere and you go, this is something to explore. So long story short, during this time, I obviously ended up working at the advertising agency, like I said, and about 9 months in, I gave my resignation because it just wasn't something that I wanted to do. And I gave in my resignation. Actually, funny enough, the same day I got a raise, I kind of left the job. It's so interesting, and it's so inevitable, the fact that if you don't enjoy what you're doing, everything in your being tells you that you have to make a change. Either it's so weird. It comes through dreams, or it just comes through divine intervention. It just feels like, wow, this just feels like I have to make a move. I can't explain it to you. It's a feeling you get. So I sold, I'm not saying everybody should do this, but I sold everything I had at the time. I was driving a little mini. I had some money saved in Alan Gray. So I had all these investments, you know, everything that the world tells you to do. And I just cashed out on everything, and I sold everything, and I went to go do the Camino. Now, I don't know if you guys know what the Camino is, but it's a pilgrimage that you walk, and it starts in France, you'll see the map here on the right-hand side. It starts in France and it goes all the way through the northern side of Spain. And you walk all the way to Santiago de Compostela. So me and one of my best friends, it's the guy here, his name is Michele, he's an Italian. And me and him sold, he was working for FedEx at the time, earning really good money and in a really good position. And both of us just went like, you know, we're not happy, we're young. At this time, I think I was 25. So we decided to sell everything and do this walk. Now, we walked for 33 days and it was just shy of 1,000 kilometers. So it was quite a journey, but one of the best things I could have ever done. So you take this whirlwind that I just came from, losing my job, working in something that I really didn't enjoy. And then by selling everything, it was my own personal reset button. And the Camino just gave me time to file my open folders in my head. You know, everything just kind of started making sense and started basically coming back together. So this trip was about 4 months long in total. I started off in London, then I took the train over to France, where I did the Camino for a month. And then that, on the way back, I went to Austria, where I met with Patrick. Patrick is the same guy I met at the design agency. Now, me and him started talking about the leather tie about 2 years prior to the Camino. And we actually tried to make some samples. I had that one sample that I made and he was busy working on some packaging ideas, etc. But nothing was really set in stone until I visited him in Austria. So on the screen now is two photos. This is the left-hand side photo was taken on the 19th of October, 2015. This was after I met with Patrick. And this was after I did about 3 weeks in Thailand, coming back after my 4 month trip. In this airplane, if I look at this image now, I just have vivid memories of looking out. I think I was, this photo was taken just as I was about to land back in Cape Town. Now, I have no money. I took all the money that I had. I think at the time I had 4,000 Rand left, I think. I don't have any job lined up. This was in October, which meant in my mind, I basically wrote off the rest of the year that I was just going to hang out with my parents again, move back home, ask them if I could borrow the family car and just be very vulnerable in this time. So I had a chat with Patrick in Austria, and on the right hand side, you see me on the phone. This is so profound because this photo was taken the exact moment I was on the phone with Patrick that phoned me on the 13th of December that said that he told one of his friends about the idea about the leather tie, and this guy's really intrigued and he wanted to know if he could be a investor in this leather tie concept. So this is me hearing that news on the 30th of December, just almost like what a day before 2016. This was a monumental shift in my life, that absolute moment on the right-hand side. So all of a sudden it comes from confusion to what am I doing with my life to, oh wow, it looks like this leather tie idea might become something. So all of a sudden we have an idea and we have money. And now we can actually make this idea become a reality. Now take the fact that I'm living in Cape Town, South Africa. Patrick lives in Graz, Austria. We're thousands of miles apart. So now in some way, we need to get this going. So we've got money. He sends me money over. So within 9 months, we have to build a company via iMessage and Skype and WhatsApp. So this is a list of things that had to happen for us, and we only had 9 months because we knew we wanted to launch close to December of 2016. So all of a sudden, I had to find office space. I had to research and buy machines for leather. I had to get staff. Believe it or not, I got my staff on Gumtree, and I still have them today. We had to come up with prototypes. We had to come up with designs of how would the prototypes look. How would they measure? We had to register a company, go to SIPSE, and actually, I've never done this in my life. So I had to take a day out of my life and literally go to Google and go, how to register a company in South Africa? And just submerge myself into the deep end of just all these intricate things that seem so scary and so daunting. I had to get import-export licenses because we knew the whole business model of this company would be to make products in South Africa and to sell them in Europe because that showcases South African art and talents. And let's face it, it's better, I think, especially now, to make euros, dollars, and pounds while you're in South Africa. I had to obviously create a business bank account, corporate identity, packaging. What does that look like? Where is that going to be made? Website. Obviously, we went with an online e-commerce store, so we had to do some research about that. Is that a website that we're going to have to build ourselves? Is that Shopify? We had to come up with a brand form because we knew we wanted to communicate this brand to a T. It's not just going to be another brand. It's going to be a lifestyle that we have to create. So a lot of time and effort had to go into that. Lifestyle photos about the products and the brand. Social media platforms, what are we going to use? The launch strategy, when are we going to post? How are we going to post? Are we going to use influencers? Then obviously retail marketing, and then obviously retail stores. So if I look at this now, it seems less daunting because I went through every single step of that. But tell this to a 25-year-old that never started his own business. It seems like a big, tall order. But one thing that I learned through all of this was if you have to just submerge yourself. And 9 times out of 10, it's not as hard as you make it to be. I mean, if I look back at it now, it took me a day to quickly register a business. So a lot of these things, if you look at it now, seem so daunting. But once you submerge yourself, things just start falling into place. So after 9 months of the hardest work I've ever done, on the 27th of September 2016 at 9:03 a.m., myself and Patrick got to showcase WEEF to the world. Now, again, it wasn't just another leather tie we're about to sell. We wanted to create a lifestyle, a brand, something someone could buy into. The best example is Apple. Every single one of us, I'm pretty sure, own some of their products because they sell the lifestyle so well. And it took us months of figuring out the communication and who is our customer and who is the person that would wear this product. So the best way I could describe all of this is this quote that I made up. And it goes, it takes years to design a ball, months to pump it up. And then once it's done, you kick it into the world and you hope it bounces. So on the 27th of September, we launched with this brand film. I wrote the script for this video. And it means a lot to me because I took inspiration from my father figures that were in my life. Hence being this WEEF is a gentleman's brand. And I had to go and get inspiration from what a gentleman really means to me. And this is what we came up with.
When I was younger, I remember watching my father get dressed for work. He told me, son, you only get one introduction to the world. That's why you need to look your best at all times. He chose every outfit carefully, taking pride in his appearance, down to the last button. The older I got, the more I realized it goes much deeper than that. Your appearance speaks 1,000 words, without a single word being spoken. These days, when I face the world, I feel like a true gentleman. We'll be right back.
I remember playing this to my parents. I was in my room, and I was very secretive about what I was doing at the time, because I've learned my lesson from telling too many people, and then life happens and you don't get to that, and then you feel as a failure, because I feel like you set yourself up by telling people about all these things, and by telling them no, but I'm busy with this massive thing, or you kind of commit to this big thing, and you know, 6 out of 10 times you don't get to it, or you change your mind or whatever. So in this case, in WEEF's case, I decided not to tell anyone about it, and just to show people once it's done. This was also a big commitment to myself, because my personality is touch. Like, I would start something and then I would lose interest, and I would start something, I would lose interest. So I remember telling my parents about this leather tie company that I'm starting. And when I played this to my parents started crying. And I started crying, because I realized that I'm onto something here. I've not just proven something to myself, but my family is incredibly proud of me. And I'm pretty sure the world would also see what we try to do. It was such an emotional, amazing, massive moment in my life, where I actually, for the first time, had an idea, committed to it, and actually executed it down to a T. So on that day, we launched with our skinny ties. This is a normal skinny tie which we made. Every single tie that we do is, it takes about 1.5 hours to construct. It's made inside out, and you have to pull it over itself to get it to the perfect shape. It took us months to get that edge perfectly straight, because we knew that if we wanted to compete with the international market, just take note, this wasn't just for South Africa. It was for the rest of the world. We didn't want to just launch another local company. This was going to be a South African-based company for the rest of the world. So it took us months to get everything perfectly, perfectly correct, and sharp edges, and the finishing was, workmanship had to be world-class. This is our skinny tie. 6 months after that, we launched our unique pocket squares and also our bow tie range. These pocket squares, I now believe, we're being copied in Bangladesh, which is a big, it's a big compliment. A lot of people would be like, but aren't you upset? I don't know. I think it's actually a compliment, if you think about it, because someone out there saw our designs and thought that it's actually good enough to copy. And I think Louis Vuitton and those big brands go through this every single day. I guess, also, what I've realized is people are very lazy to come up with their own ideas, and it's so easier just to copy someone else's. This is our packaging. Every single unit is sealed and numbered by the craftsman. So when you buy a tie and you open it up, you have to break the seal. It's numbered, and it's the special unit. And also, because it's leather, it's timeless. So we now do a lot of weddings where people do, they buy gifts for people, say for weddings, and it lasts. And it's basically a gift that's timeless. If you get married in a tie, then your child could wear that same tie to get married in. It can kind of be this unique piece in your, you know, in your life. We also engrave on the ties, which makes it very special and unique. We, like I said, we launched with 6 cutters. And this is our red one, the oxblood red, the pocket square, the bow tie. And there's our packaging too. Also on the right-hand side, these are our lifestyle images. We wanted to make sure that the lifestyle images portrays the packaging, portrays the actual product. In advertising, they call it the golden thread. If you see the ad and you see the images and you go to the website and you actually order the product, all those things must tell the same story. And that's what I learned at AAA. Cool. So that was basically what we did and what we launched with from a product point of view. And I think this brings me to this slide, because as I explained to you guys before, in my mind, my end goal was WEEF. I was going to launch a brand called WEEF, but I didn't know that it's not the destination, but it's the journey. And this is basically, I would like to share what opportunities has come from this journey called WEEF. Firstly, I had to submerge myself in education. Never Have I learned so much about brands, about the industry, about product development? So it kind of forced me to jump into education, from YouTube videos to tutorials to, I had to learn Photoshop. I had to learn how to edit some videos, how to edit some photos. So, you know, on the road to the goal, education was one of them. Respect and credibility. Self-respect, like I said, all of a sudden I've committed to something and I've actually, you know, gone through with it. And also credibility. This is an interesting one, because all of a sudden, after launching this brand, I had more credibility from people and friends and also family members, because all of a sudden I wasn't just a big dreamer. I was also seen as a doer, and people have a lot of respect for people that don't just talk, but actually do. Traveled my whole life, and I'm pretty sure every single one of you guys, traveling is one of the biggest things that, and one of the most exciting things that could ever happen to anyone, because you travel to a different country and it just explodes your brain with, it basically just learns you about different cultures and it expands your vision and your mindset. And this was something that I always wanted to do. Also, personal fulfillment. This comes back to all of a sudden my life feels like it's got purpose. You know, I'm not just dabbling around. I've actually committed to something and I've made something. Creative freedom. I think this comes to, you know, you all of a sudden you've tested your creative boundaries and you've gone, ooh, well, if this is doable, then maybe that's doable. And it's amazing how you test your abilities through a journey like this. Job opportunities that have just been popping up left, right, and center. I can't explain to you. I've been offered to be the head brand ambassador for well-known local South African brands, all because people see and have latched credibility to my name because of what I've done. All of a sudden, people go, no, but he would definitely be able to run that because he just did that. So that's been a very big eye-opener. Also with expanding my networks, not just people, but also companies and networks around the world. It's most definitely given me self-confidence, and also which then led to other business ventures. So you must understand that I'm selling leather tires. This isn't rocket science. I didn't come up with, you know, an Uber app. I'm selling leather tires, which is nicher than niche in the leather industry. And all of a sudden, you know, like my mind is going, ooh, but if people are buying into this, then surely they would be able to buy into other ideas that I have. And that's the last line. It's reignited and broadened the ability to dream big, and that anything is actually possible. I mean, if I can sell leather ties and sell that around the world, it's been a very big eye-opener to myself. And I want to show you what exactly WEEF has, if it comes down to traveling, has actually brought me personally. In the last 2 years, I have traveled 18 international countries. Everything to Las Vegas, to Dubai, Austria, Italy, most of Europe, Chicago, Japan. And all of this is because of leather ties. I still, even if I look at this now, I laugh, because never in my wildest dreams did I think that a leather tie company would take me around the world. I've also actually put together a little video, which I would love to share with you guys. I've tried to capture, 2018 was one of the craziest years, and also 2019. But I've tried to capture it into a video, and I would love to share that with you guys, just how crazy my life was. It was basically 2 weeks at home, 2 weeks on an international flight, then back for 2 weeks and all that. And before I go to the video, just again, the strategy wasn't just another South African company. This was a local company that was going to obviously supply international. There's a saying that goes, act local, think global. And this was exactly our whole vision. I was traveling to all these countries to take what we had in South Africa and to share it with the rest of the world.
When I was younger, I was terrified of flying. just the concept of how that massive machine launches into the sky, carrying myself and all the passengers with their luggage for hours, still blows my mind. As I grew older, I realized I was actually afraid of the turbulence. You know, the unknown, the fear of being so high, so vulnerable. A friend once explained the concept of turbulence to me, of how at high altitudes there are pockets of hot and cold air in the sky, causing the massive machine to rise and fall mid-flight. And now that I'm older, I've realized that it's actually the turbulence that makes a journey an adventure.
That was just a little bit of a snippet, but I remember in 2018, I did so much traveling that I had a suitcase constantly just packed for like my next trip. I kind of felt like a rock star because every like 2 weeks you're in a different country. And also guys, just again, I'm selling leather ties. I'm not in finance. I'm not doing, you know, I'm not selling, I don't know, I'm not in the restaurant industry, whatever. I'm selling leather ties. It's that simple. But I think the thing that really stood out to me, and sometimes when I would sit on these planes, I would get emotional because I'm like, I've always wanted to do this and I've always wanted to travel. And all I needed was this thing, this idea, this thing to come to life. And in my case, it was this brand called WEEF that was selling leather ties that was the catalyst to get me around the world. And then also going into other ventures. So this is one of them. So you must understand that after we launched, people looked at our brand form, looked at our photos and looked at our packaging and went, hey, who did all your creative work? So then myself and Patrick, who lives in Austria, decided, wait a minute, let's create an advertising agency but then focus on European clients. So what we did was we created this company called Branded, and Patrick would get the European clients and then I would do the content creation for them in South Africa. This is a perfect business model because we would charge in euros and then use local creatives in South Africa, filmmakers, videographers, photographers, and then create the content for European brands. So this is one of the journeys that came from WEEF. So we got credibility from WEEF as a brand, which gave people enough trust for us to work on their brand. So I would like to share a little video of our content creation and exactly what we've been up to. Again, WEEF gave us credibility to actually sell ourselves to the international market. And WEEF is a brand that has been running for 3 years. We've done, I think, almost 11 international campaigns in that time. And it hasn't just given me an international portfolio, it's also helped me employ local talent in South Africa and pay them a better rate because we're getting paid in euros. Again, I was selling leather ties. This screen is profound. This is my third venture that I started less than a month ago. So the whole idea behind this was, as an entrepreneur, I understand the journey, and I wanted to create a platform where I interview professional founders. And because I think a lot of people want to hear about the brand, but not a lot of people ask the real questions about the founder. How did you start? Tell me the story. Where did you grow up? Where did you get the idea? I wanted to create a platform to actually understand and learn from those intricate stories. So Profound is a platform which we want to interview local and international talent, anything from music to tech to the business world to, you know, if I can, I would like to interview Leon Schuster and Anton Rupert. But again, I wouldn't be sitting on those chairs interviewing these people if I didn't pay my own school fees. And by being an entrepreneur and by starting my own business, I'm sitting at the same table as these guys, which gives me the credibility to actually interview them. Because in my interview invitation emails, I'm going, "Hi there, my name is Dévan Swanepoel. These are the ventures that I have personally. I would love to interview you about your venture." And 9 out of 10 times people go, "Would love to do that." Again, people also love talking about themselves, but this is an amazing opportunity for me to also capture these interviews and inspire people through other people's stories. So this brings me to the newest venture, which is my own website. It's devonswanepoel.com, and it's basically, in this time and in this COVID time, I've realized that, and I've got a few pointers in closing about that, which I'll share with you now. But in this time in COVID, I had to sit down and really consolidate what it is that I enjoy doing and what it is that I'm good at. And one of the things is, one of the main thing, which is I'm actually a project producer. And in any sense, from a physical product to videos to photos to helping people with their brands, anything producer, that's what I am. And I've started creating my own portfolio for the local and international market, where I showcase all the work that I've done and also try and get more project producer work locally. Again, I started with leather ties, but it's given me the self-confidence. And yes, I understand it's very bold to use your name as a company, but you know what? Why not? Why are you building other brands if you could start building your own personal brand? Okay, so in closing, there's two of the final things that I would like to share with you guys. Also, I've put every single video link and all of these takeouts on a PDF, which I'm going to share with you guys. And you can go through the links and check out everything. Just as a leave behind. But basically, in a nutshell, in my 31 years, what I've learned on this journey is you have to cut out distractions. When I started WEEF, I stopped socializing. I actually stopped drinking alcohol for 3.5 years, and I managed to save 250,000 Rand. I had an app that would actually calculate that for me. So my friends would go, I would go, "Oh my goodness, I've always got this disposable cash," because I wasn't spending my money on socializing. I was spending it on my business. And that also helped me travel as much as I did. 250,000 Rand is a lot of money. And I mean, I understand Stellenbosch and I understand all the lifestyle. All I'm saying is be careful, because you can spend that like that, where that could have actually helped you build a company. Obviously, because of that, and not being as social, I lost a lot of friends. So I realized that some of the closest friends that I have are the ones that were there from the beginning of the journey. And those are the friends that I keep dear to me. I had to have balance, work and family, because it's so easy to get submerged into work. Self-education, 24/7. If I didn't know something, I would YouTube it. I always take notes wherever I go. If I'm on a plane, on a train, I always take out my notes app on my iPhone and I just jot down ideas, because you never know when those ideas would ever pop up. Travel as much as you ever can. Collaboration is king. You'll see this with big brands like Supreme and Bape and all those big stuff, big brands. They would do collaborations with Louis Vuitton or other brands. And this is great for a brand, for both brands, because it shows that you are willing to, you know, come up with fresh ideas and collaborate. And it also pushes both of your brands, because Louis Vuitton will push Supreme and Supreme will push Louis Vuitton. So this is what I've learned in WEEF too. And as it stands now, we do a lot of collaboration work. Forget what people think. Once you do that, you're actually free to do whatever you want without judgment, because people are too busy worrying about themselves to actually worry about you. Play on your own strengths. Again, it took me 4 years to realize that I'm actually a project producer, but I had to go through all these things to go, okay, cool, this is actually something I enjoy doing and this is what I need to do. And some people get that when they're done with school, they find their direction. It took me this long to realize what I really wanted to do. No time is wasted time. If you guys go back to that first slide about me, when I had a mustache when I was 8, that time was, if I look at that whole timeline, never did I know that I would end up where I am now, which meant that everything I studied, from acting to advertising to business, at some point in my life would all seamlessly merge together. So no time is wasted time. All roads lead to other roads. This is the main takeout. I thought I was heading to this destination, but little did I know that there were so many avenues and adventures along the way. Set goals, write them down. Sometimes you have to keep them to yourself, but just make sure that you execute. Excuse me. People respect the doer, not a talker. And the last thing, something people don't teach you in high school is perseverance. You have to keep on persevering. This is something that, it's almost like nature. You know, the animal that perseveres is the animal that comes out the strongest. You have to persevere, because this is the key thing that all successful people have that other people don't, because people lose interest. You have to, if you really want it so badly, perseverance is the goal. Okay, so this brings me to my second last slide. This is just focused on COVID at the moment. And it's just a few things that I, and just before we get to questions, this is just a few things that I wanted to just show you guys what I have basically adapted myself in this time. Be forever flexible. When COVID happened, my online retail business, WEEF, couldn't sell because we were non-essential. So we had to come up with other ideas. Also, I had to then all of a sudden focus my attention to online work, to my advertising portfolio. And since COVID started to now, I've been building websites and doing animation videos for a company in France. So it's good to kind of be adaptable and forever flexible. Follow your gut. If it feels right, do it. Don't overthink it or second guess it. If it feels right, do it. Your gut is 10 out of 10, always right. Don't be so hard on yourself. It doesn't always have to be perfect. Just do it. I mean, this is something that I also tell myself often. I'm pretty much a perfectionist and it needs to be super smooth before I give it out to the world. But at the end of the day, it's better to actually produce something than not producing it because it's 95%. And also, it takes 100% to go from 95 to 100. And more than ever, 95% is good enough. This is focused on your generation, the younger generation. I want to tell you that you do have a seat at the table. Don't think because you're younger, your opinions don't count. If you look at young entrepreneurs that are really making it big, like Ninja, who's an online gamer, he's making millions, absolutely millions. And I remember when I was your age, my parents would tell me, video gaming isn't going to bring you anywhere. You know, bless their souls. But this is created industries. So even at your age right now, you do have a seat at the table and your voice is should be heard, because young kids are coming up with the solutions for COVID right now. It's the young minds that are actually the ones that we need to listen to. Also, the world is counting on you. You guys are the next generation. So it's on your shoulders to come up with the new solution. Again, be light in all sense. I'm trying to live a more minimalistic lifestyle. If I don't need it, I don't buy it. I don't own a credit card. I've never owned a credit card. And I'm trying to be as light as possible from a financial point of view. This has saved me in this COVID time. My expenses every month is minimal. And I keep it like that. If I can't afford a car, I'm not going to pay off a BMW every month for 5,000 Rand. I'd rather take that money and buy myself a 50,000 Rand car cash and not have down payments every month. Because as an entrepreneur, I want to be light. If an opportunity opens in New York City tomorrow, guess what? I'm packing my bags and I'm going. I'm not going to have a mortgage and paying off a car keep me down. Again, this is my outlet. But this has come to help me a lot in this time. Have a few tabs open. Always have a few fingers in the pie. Again, if it wasn't for my advertising business, I wouldn't have had this opportunity to create this job for this European company. So it's good to have a few fingers in pies. This is also, again, my personality, but it did pay off, especially in this time. And then again, the last thing is start today. The best time to plant a tree is 20 years ago. The second best time to plant a tree is today. Just start and start today. I want to leave you guys with this. This is a chart of your life. So it goes from 0 to 90 years, right? So this is obviously if you're lucky. The red dot is me. This is my life. And the green dot is your life. I've obviously averaged it out. So I thought if you guys had to finish high school last year, most of you guys would be 19 and a half. So forgive me if I'm not completely on point here. But I remember being the green dot the other day. And now I'm the red dot. This is life in front of your eyes right now. And it goes like that. And the thing I want to leave you with is you only get one life, but if you do it right, one is enough. Cool, guys. Thank you so much for your time. I know I spoke a lot, but I really wanted to cram everything in here. And please, please, please ask me any questions. I'm open. I think I've gone over time. Forgive me. But I hope this has resonated with some of you guys, because again, I've got a lot of respect for you. You guys are our next generation and I'm rooting for you guys. And yeah, thank you again for your time. Questions and go.
Okay. Dévan, first of all, I just want to say thank you very much. I don't mind that you went over time. It is amazing what you've shared. There was a lot of comments, so I would actually love for them to ask you comments. They find it really motivating. Somebody's asking, what are some of the mistakes you wish you could have avoided?
In the beginning of WEEF, remember, if you have an idea, then you're very starry-eyed. And I remember in the beginning, we were friends that were all going to start this together. And I'm very, very glad that I didn't accept all my friends into the company, because working with friends in a company can be very, very challenging. Especially now, 4 years later in the brand, I've realized that if you don't have the right partners in your company, it can really damage your company or really bring your company down. So if you are starting something, just be careful who you adding into the company, because it might bite you, you know, later down the line. So I think that was one of the biggest things. And also, when we got the funding, the one thing I didn't do was this is a stupid mistake, but I learned my lesson. I didn't work in my day-to-day costs for starting WEEF. So after the money was spent on all the tools we needed to start the business, I was like, how am I going to pay my petrol and medical aid and my running costs? So I had to get a 9-to-5 to help me cover those costs. And I think in the beginning, the pitch would be, this is what we need for the company, and this is what I need for myself to build the company. So that was a rookie mistake, but praise the Lord, I did end up finding part-time work that covered my costs while I was building WEEF. I hope that answered your question.
Okay, they also ask, how did you choose the name WEEF and what does it mean?
So I'm Afrikaans. WEEF is to weef and in English to weave. And I think when we had the idea, the initial idea was that South Africa, me and Patrick in Europe, so South Africa weaving with the rest of the world, and the fact that leather weaves really well with other materials. So that was kind of the initial thing behind. But it was really difficult to come up with the name, but once I heard it, it felt right. It's like coming up with your child's name. It's very difficult, but I think once you hear it and you live with it a bit, it kind of becomes your new normal.
And then there was a question regarding, are you mostly online or in shops?
So we're mostly an online company. I think it's just for margins. Obviously, if somebody buys directly from us, that's the best margins for any company because you're not in a retail space. We are, about a year ago, we changed the model to be more in retail. So obviously, that's a few options. People would take consignment stock, which means that they would take on your product as a display in their store. You won't pay a monthly rental fee for your product, but if the product is sold, you would get your cut from that. So that's something we've been doing. And currently we're in shops around the world. We're currently in New York, in Japan, in Dubai, and also in Austria. Yeah, as it is right now. So we try to, and also in Chicago, we try to place our products at really key global markets as it is, because obviously the person that purchases a leather tie is a urban commuter in very busy and wealthy cities.
Okay. There's lots of questions, Dévan. I'm battling to keep up here. So the next one is, except for losing your friends, how else did entrepreneurship change or affected your life?
Just repeat that again.
The entrepreneurship, except for losing your friends, how did it affect your life?
How long is a piece of string? That answer is very complex, but I think it has given me personal self-worth. I think that is something money can't buy. I mean, you have entrepreneurs that have billions of rands, but they've never, it's maybe inherited money and it's empty money. And I think everybody in this life wants to find something that they feel their life is means something, you know? And I think entrepreneurship has given me, and also the brand has given me a reason for my life, I think, if that makes any sense. Losing friends and all that, that's actually the natural progression of how it should be, because I can't even relate to those friends that just want to party anymore, because those friends are not fulfilling me on an emotional, mental level anymore. And those people, sorry to say, I'm just not associating with anymore. And those people are the same people, and forgive me for this, those people are the same people that find those mundane 9-to-5 jobs and are always complaining when you chat to them. I don't have any time for people trying to be the victim. You have to take responsibility for your life. And those are the people that I hang out with. I email people like Casey Neistat. I have interviews with people like John Sonne, because I reach for these big entrepreneurs and I learn from them. And that just builds me as a person and just sharpens my sword as an individual and as an entrepreneur.
Dévan, I'm going to let them ask you the questions themselves because it goes off my screen. So there's so many questions. The next question was, do you see YouTube, and after they must ask their own questions, as more of a learning tool or as an entertainment tool? Where do you see it going?
That's an interesting question. I think like anything else, it's got balance. So I go onto YouTube to be inspired, and I go onto YouTube to listen to music, and I go onto YouTube to learn. I've learned most of what I know about Photoshop and Premiere Pro and Lightroom from YouTube, But then again, when I feel like I want to be entertained, then I would watch a Casey Neistat video, or I love tech videos as well, because tech really intrigues me, because that's where it's going. So to answer your question, I think it's what you make out of it. If you want to learn, it's there. If you want to be entertained, it's there too. The one thing I want to talk about tech as well is, ladies and gentlemen, you live in a time where you could have a backpack on your back, the latest MacBook Pro and the new Sony A-series camera with detachable lenses in a backpack. So the point I'm trying to make is, we live in a time where your equipment isn't weighing you down. A freelance videographer or editor or animator can literally be as light as you and your backpack with your equipment. And that excites me so much, because Apple and these guys are pushing their limits all the time, and things are just getting smaller and lighter. And I think that's the world we're moving into. This is a bit of a side note, but just have that simmer a bit.
Okay, can you find the next question, please?
I have a question. It's about collaboration. So I studied art last year, so I have quite a few ideas for collaborations and starting like clothing also, and a printmaking studio. And I'm just wondering how to go about collaborations, because I know all of these creatives, but I'm trying to like go into it wisely, so that what we create is like owned by the right person, or that everybody wins from the situation. Like say from my clothing side, is when we collaborate, it still needs to be part of my brand and my business.
Yeah. That's also very intricate. I think the way that I did it was, I went to a lawyer and I got a non-disclosure document. So before I had any meeting, I would have them sign the document. And this seems strange, but let me tell you, once a business launches and it starts getting traction, everyone wants a piece of the pie. And you have to make sure that all your bases is covered. This is normal standard practice these days, to have a non-disclosure. And even through friends, it's like, hey man, do you mind just signing this document? It's just legal, and it's on, you know, it's on a piece of paper. And it's not about, I don't trust you. It's just, you know, if you trust me, and if you respect me, then for me to share my ideas with you in a world that we're currently living in, you would respect the fact that I would, you know, want you just to sign this piece of paper. Other than that, ideas are just ideas if they're not executed. So in the one sense, you want to collaborate and you want to make things happen. And I think you should ask yourself the question, do I want to make it happen because I want the idea to be birthed? Or do I want to make it happen because I want to make money out of this? I guess the sweet spot is to have best of both. But I've always just been pretty cautious about it. And I would rather have someone sign a document, and then I know all my bases is covered. I actually had a guy that were making the ties in the beginning, because we outsourced the ties before we made it ourselves. This guy was going to ask me 420 Rand cost price to make one leather tie, okay? Which means I wouldn't be able to sell this in South Africa at all. So praise the Lord, I had him sign a non-disclosure before we started WEEF. And he tried to bully me into selling leather ties too. And he said, I will bring the price down to 200 Rand a tie cost if you also allow me to do ties. And he was a massive leather production company. And all I did was I took out that piece of paper and I said, sorry, sir, but you know, you signed this, so legally you're not allowed to do this. Mm-hmm. And after that, I completely terminated the relationship, because I just realized that but there are people out there that want to copy your idea. And because you're a child, they see you as a child and they would just drive right over you. So the one thing that saved my company, in a sense, was the fact that I had that piece of paper signed, and that guy couldn't do anything, and he never did. So that's my opinion. Thank you, Marguerite, for the question.
Of course. I have one more question. How do you feel about startups like right now with this whole COVID thing? So surviving COVID is one thing, but if you want to start something new, wait it out? Or what is your opinion on like startups at the moment?
Marguerite, the best time to do, okay, the best time to start a startup and do the groundwork is right now. What do you have? You've got time, right? We're not allowed to get out of the house. So what am I doing? I'm sitting in front of my computer, building my own website, learning how to build my own website. Get the skeleton of your company right now. Do all the research. I've created my social accounts. I've started writing my bio copy. I've started rearranging all my projects. I'm just as an example for what I'm busy with now. This is the perfect time to be as productive as you possibly can. And all you need to do after COVID is literally just press the launch button. So make sure everything, register your company, open up your bank account. Most of these things you can do online. The best time to do it is right now. Make sure that you get all your ducks in a row. And once everything is sorted, you can go and after COVID just launch. That's in my opinion. I think this has actually been a blessing. And I personally have actually loved this time because for the first time in my life, I could get more routine back into my life. I've never read so much that I've done in this time. I've never meditated so much. I've never exercised as much. It's forced me to be in routine. And I feel like personally, COVID has been a blessing in disguise because I was running on fumes before COVID came. And I'm pretty sure a lot of people would agree with me here. It has given us the time just to reset, look inwards, and also focus on the things that you are passionate about. Last thing I wanted to say, we launched Profound in this time, in COVID. Why? Because everyone was online. Everyone was looking for inspirational things. And that's exactly what Profound was. It took us 2 weeks to edit the footage, to create the website, and to launch the brand. And it couldn't come at a better time.
Okay, Ivan?
Does that answer your question? Yes.
Hi, so I wanted to ask, you mentioned earlier that you were involved in a bunch of different opportunities, like you said, fingers in a bunch of different pies, or however the expression goes. How did you actively seek out those opportunities, or did they come to you, or a little bit of a mix of both? And how did you know which opportunity was right?
That's a very good question, Ivan, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
Thank you so much. That's a very good question. And most of these opportunities came out of the blue. So I would get inbox messages. Hey, we saw WEEF. We love the video. We love what you did with the brand. Can we go for coffee? So I would always be open for a coffee. And still to this day, I'm always open for coffee, especially when people reach out to me, because it means that it almost shows a bit of a commitment from their side. So I would go, I would meet with coffee. And in this case, it was a role to be the head marketing manager of a massive local brand. And I went for the coffee, and then the coffee became a second and a third meeting. And then they basically offered me the opportunity to take this thing. And they gave me a day or two to think about it. And I went back to my core. This is, again, I'm just explaining how I experienced this whole thing. I asked my question, is it about the money for me, or is it about the personal fulfillment? And if I took that role, WEEF would have been smothered by my time, because they would steal my time from me, and then that would ultimately smother WEEF. And I would then, again, just become another slave to another company, and my dreams and ambitions that I had would just be contained in their little box in the way that they would want to allocate my time. So I know this sounds very negative, but I have worked in 9-to-5 jobs, and I do understand hierarchy and understand all those things. I'm not someone that, the only thing that I have in my life is my time, and that's mine. And I will not submit that to someone else if I'm not very, very passionate about what it is, and if it's not adding to my main goal. So if this was an opportunity to work in-house at Supreme or Louis Vuitton in France, absolutely I would take it. And I would more take it if it was like for a 6 months or project-based time. So I know that it's not a long...
It's a short burst of time. Can you guys hear me? My AirPods just died.
Yeah.
No, it's actually clearer.
Okay. Okay, great. Sorry. So to answer your question, if it's in line with what you want to do, absolutely, at your age, you can learn a lot from being employed at that time. But personally, on the journey that I was, I knew that a 9-to-5 or any opportunity at that time would smother my goal and my ideas for my brand. And just be careful when you don't just work because work is work and work makes you money. That's a horrible way to look at it. Do something that you're passionate about or do something that is in line with where you're going. Does that make any sense?
Yeah.
Yes, thank you.
Okay.
Awesome.
Laura?
Hi.
Laura? Praat bietjie harder.
Can you hear me?
Very softly.
Yeah, a little bit softly. There we go.
Okay, so I just want to know, as someone who has both businesses under a created brand name, but you also have something under your own name, do you think there's any value in building a brand around your person, like defining yourself as a kind of brand?
Absolutely, and I think it's more valuable now than ever. You must understand that businesses come and go, ventures come and go, but you will always be there. And that is the approach that I've taken right now. If you look at some of the biggest guys out there, you know, like, I'm going to reference back to Casey Neistat or someone like Simon Sinek, or someone like Elon Musk. You know, yes, he's got Tesla and he's got all these big brands, but him himself is the main leader, the main brand. It all connects back to him. If Elon Musk creates a side project, that's going to become a success because it's Elon Musk. He's not hiding behind a brand, if you know what I'm saying. And I think the time to communicate your own brand, your own skills, things that you're passionate about is very, very valuable. And that's exactly what I'm doing with devanswanepoel.com. It's taken me time because I feel like I felt very uncomfortable by putting my name out there. I mean, it feels arrogant and bold in a way, but maybe that's the push that I needed. And people need to think what they need to think. At the end of the day, I was the person that created those jobs. I don't think it makes sense to hide behind branded for the rest of my life, where I could be taking on more projects under my own name. And it makes me so flexible and so light because they work with me directly. I don't have to pay agency overheads or pay salaries or buy a new MacBook for Jonathan because his MacBook broke because he's part of the agency. It's me and it's my stuff. You know what I'm saying? So it might sound selfish to some. I just feel like the ultimate goal for me is to be working as a subcontractor in other brands, because then I would work 3 months with Ferrari coming up with their, I don't know, leather wallet. And then once that 3 months is done, I move over to Louis Vuitton to work on their leather belts. That's cool. Because now in a year, I'm doing 3 or 4 of those, which is growing me more than I would being in a mundane, I don't know, 9-to-5. Does that make sense? Sorry, I'm talking a lot, but that's just how I communicate.
Okay, thank you. And I just have one last thing to ask. What is the name of the app you used to track how much money you were saving?
It's called Quit That. It's a free app that you can download and you just put in, you can quit anything, sugar, alcohol, cigarettes. And every day it shows you, obviously you would put in the amount of money that a packet of cigarettes cost you. I don't know where you would find cigarettes now, but then it would just track that. And then every week you can go, oh goodness, I've saved 200 Rand this week. And it becomes like an addiction. And then you kind of, personally, I made like a personal pact with myself to see how long I can push it. And then after 3.5 years, on an average, you know, money that I would spend on alcohol, it accumulated to 250,000
Okay. Before I give the last question, Dévan, to the students, there's been a new meeting invite sent via email to you. And the next meeting is starting at 10 o'clock. So if any of you feel at the moment that you want to leave and quickly have a break, coffee or whatever, do it. And then Peter can ask this question. Dévan, I'm so sorry that we actually have to stop this because there's so comments and questions. I think they'll have you here most of the day if they could. But we'll send another formal thank you note. I'm sure that this recording will also be sent to you very soon. Thank you so much. For everything. I think there's so much value in what you taught us or what you shared with us. It is very amazing. And I want to say that I honor and respect you for what you've done up to such a young age in your life and what you stand for. So,
Thank you so much.
Okay. And thanks for being a motivator and the influencer.
I really appreciate it. Thank you so much. I think just before we end this, I just want to ask anyone that has questions. I'm in front of my computer today. I would love to connect with you guys. On this page, you can see my information. And I'm also going to email a little PDF that I made for you guys as a takeout with all my contact information and everything. And please feel free to reach out to me. I would love to learn and help you on your journey.
Okay. There's one more question. It's from Peter Baker. Peter?
Can you hear me?
Yeah, boy.
I just wanted to ask, do you have any tips on how to kind of think of like a product that would change the world? Kind of like, any tips of like how to just sit down and kind of think of one, or does it just come naturally, just pop up in your head?
That's a very interesting question. And I keep on asking myself that too. And my friends sometimes ask me the same thing. It's so weird. It's like, you know that feeling that you get when you drink a cup of coffee and the caffeine kicks in and you feel like you can conquer the world?
I get
waves of that in my day where I just something pops up and then I take out my notes app or I take my journal and I just jot it down. And then later when you have reflection time, you kind of explore the idea, because sometimes you would jot down something, but the more time you put into it, the more it becomes this massive like thing. So the only advice I can give to you is let creativity flow through you. Allow it to flow through you. Don't fight the flow. And write down the little golden nuggets and just make sure that you explore them. And out of those golden nuggets, opportunity will come out.
Yeah, awesome. Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you very much, everybody. It is on my computer now, 3 minutes before the next meeting. Dévan, thank you again, and we have to run to the next one, so
yes.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, everyone. Have a great day, and we'll stay in touch. Please email me.
Thanks, Dévan.
Thanks.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you, David.
Bye.